Hello friends, this is Vasant Nayak from Vastech channel. Please subscribe to our channel. We will update latest information for you.
Hello students, welcome to this presentation session of computer networking for 5th semester CS and IS students of 15 series syllabus. For explanation purpose, I use a PPT from Computer Networking book written by James F. Kuroso. So once again, welcome back. So this is a revision session, so we will not go in detail. We will just try to cover some of the important concept. So your first module, you are going to study various application layers protocols, principles of networking applications, various application layers protocols such as HTTP, FTP, SMTP, POP3, IMAP, DNS, P2P and socket programming using UDP and TCP. So in this session, I will try to cover application layer protocol except socket programming and P2P applications. So now, yes, students, before proceeding, we will see now, we will recall OSI model. OSI model is nothing but Open System Interconnect model, which has got 7 layers and each layer has got particular functionality. In the diagram, you can see here, this is OSI model with the application layer, presentation layer, session layer, transport layer, network layer, detailing layer and physical layer. The same model. So alternative to OSI model, we have one more model that is called as a TCP model or DoD model, Department of Defense. So this has got 5 layers, application. Here application means 3 layers of OSI model is clubbed into one and it is called as application. Second one is the transport, third one is the internet, fourth one is the data link and fifth one is the physical layer. So 5 layer modalities. So now in our discussion, that is throughout our syllabus, module 1 deals with the normally application layers of OSI model, and module 2 with the reliable and unreliable protocol TCP and UDP. Module 3 is about routing and switching. So module 3 is about routing and switching, and module 4 is about mobile or cellular network, and module 5 is about multimedia network. Module 5 is about multimedia network. So that multimedia network is not related to this one, so please ignore. So now application layers, we will take now application layer of a TCP model. When you take the application layer of TCP model, it contains 3 layers. And what are the protocols comes under? The protocol comes under file transfer is TFTP, FTP, NFS. Protocol under email is SMTP. Protocol under remote login is Telnet, R-login. Protocol under network management is SNMP. And protocol under name management is DNS. All these protocols we are going to discuss. So after that, once this is over, then we will move to our application layer, transport layer, where we will discuss reliable data delivery, RDT protocols and UDP. Then internet or network layer, where we will discuss IP, ICMP, all those protocols. So with this, my dear students, I will take back to once again our PPT. So now application layers deals with the different types of application, it provides different type of network application services. All these services we call like protocol, like TFTP service, FTP service, SMTP service, DNS service, etc. But now, while creating network applications, our programmer need not to worry about the core of the need not to worry about the core device, because whatever application our network developer going to create will work on the end machine or end system. So you need not to know much more about the core device, because all these applications will not work on the core device. In the diagram you can see here, these are the end devices where application runs especially. And in between we can see the different networks are there, or all these end systems are connected by means of a wide area network. And how these end systems communicates, you can see. So when our network developer develop the applications, network applications, you need not worry about the intermediate device. That is the one meaning. Then application architecture. Architecture is, there are two types of architecture. One is client server architecture, other one is a peer-to-peer architecture. Client server architecture. See, in the diagram you can see. So first of all, what is a client and what is a server? Server is a device which provides services. Different type of services, print service, file service, etc. And a client is a device which requests for the services. So client server architecture, server always on host. So you can see here server, and it has got always, normally server has got permanent IP address. That means server is not a movable device. It is a permanent IP address. And server remains in data centers, and data centers are scalable. Normally servers are implemented in terms of data centers, and data centers use scalability, like depending on the user data, etc., etc. Clients communicate to the server over the network, and client are normally movable, and client may have dynamic IP address always. And client, they are don't connect each other. Normally clients connect through server. For example, the user traveling here is using mobile, and he communicates to the server, and he will try to access the information. Similarly, user is using a laptop and is trying to access the information. So one more architecture is peer-to-peer architecture. So here there is no question of server. Client itself acts like a server, and client itself try to access other client and try to access the information. So it is self scalability. Only thing is the problem with this P2P architecture is here security implementation is very much difficult, and management is also somewhat complex. It is a self-scalability, new fears being new service capacity. New fears bring new services capacity as well as new service demands. So you can see here, peer-to-peer architecture. Then process is nothing but the program runs on the within the host. So within the within the same host, the process communicates. That is, process is called inter-process communicates. And then normally it is within the OS. Then the process in a different host communicates by exchanging message. So there are two types of process, a client process and a server process. So you can, these process communicates by means of sockets. You can see here, application layer, process on the application layer. This is controlled by the application developer normally, You can see here, it is controlled by the application developer. And whatever these, the process running here and all, it is controlled by the OS. So you can see here two applications, they communicate by means of application program interface, and that is normally known as socket. What is socket? Socket is nothing but in other way I can say combination of connection, which is referred by, or which is addressed by IP address and port number. So normally this process send data through the socket to the other end. So this each process have got some certain number, certain identification, or that number is called the socket number. Normally, each machine on internet is identified by unique IP address, 32-bit IP address. A single system can contain many processes, can run many processes. So these processes are identified by IP address and port number. For example, in the diagram you can see here, this is the IP address along with the port number. This is called as socket normally. And processes are identified by with the IP address and port number. Same IP address, port number can be different for SMTP process. Same IP address, the port number can be different for FTP. Like this, it works. So identifier includes both address and port numbers. So application layer protocols, you know protocol. What is the protocol? It is the rules governs the communication between two systems. Like it involves type of messages exchanged, like request message and response message, and it involves syntax and semantics, and rules like when and how the process should send and respond to the message. So the various open standard protocols are there, and the proprietary protocols also there, application layer. Then our application layer, what it actually need from the transport layer. Transport layer, application layer needs data integrity, that is reliable data. Then timing, because some applications are time sensitive, that is it require low delay and should be effective. Some applications are loss tolerant. All those things can be considered here. Throughput, you see here, some application like multimedia requires minimum amount of throughput to be effective. Other applications, those applications are called as elastic applications, make use of whatever throughput they get. For example, some application like email and all, whatever application like elastic applications, but some multimedia applications are like non-elastic, it requires some minimum amount of this one. Security, one more concern. So here, this chart you can see, like email, no loss, but it is elastic, no time sensitive, but we will take audio, video, or games, loss tolerant, and time sensitive. So we have transport layer protocol, which helps application layer, that is TCP. TCP is a reliable transport layer protocol which provides flow control and congestion control and timing, and it is a connection oriented, means a three-way handshake is established between client and server before sending data. UDP is an unreliable protocol and don't provide reliability, flow control, congestion control, timing, throughput, etc., etc., etc. So now our protocols like SMTP, which makes use of TCP. Telnet makes use of TCP. HTTP makes use of TCP. FTP TCP. Then some HTTP streaming multimedia makes use of TCP or UDP. Internet telephone like Skype, SIP, RTP, and all makes use of either TCP or UDP. So these are the application layer protocols. These are the underlying transport layer protocols. Streaming and all makes use of, some streaming makes use of UDP because UDP is faster. But some type of protocol like SMTP, Telnet, HTTP and all makes use of TCP only. So now, first one is nothing but web and HTTP protocol. We know web pages consist of objects. So each object is, objects can be either HTML or JPG. JPEG image, Java applet, and each object is addressed by URL, universal resource locator. And you can see here, universal resource locator, this one full, this is the host name, this is the path name of that object in that particular host. So this is called as URL. So now, next one is, HTTP is a client-server protocol. So you can see it is a server. So client requests service from the server, which hosts web pages, and that server is called as a In Windows, it is called as IIS, Internet Information Service Server, and in Linux and all, it is called as Apache Web Server. So all those things you can see here. So in that, either your iPhone running some software browser or our PC running Firefox, it requests for HTTP request and it will get response. You can see this is the HTTP overview. Now HTTP makes you use TCP. TCP means it is reliable. It works on port number 80. And it will establish three-way handshake before the data transfer, then it will transfer the data. But you have to remember, it is a stateless. It will not maintain the information about the fast this client request. That's why that sometimes becomes difficult. So this is a HTTP connection. In HTTP connections are there are two types, non-persistence and persistence. Non-persistence is the one to download multiple objects, multiple connections are required. But persistence connection with single connection, multiple objects can be downloaded. And you can see a non-persistence. HTTP initiates the TCP connection to HTTP server here. This is the address on port number and server will respond. And the client will acknowledge. Then after that, HTTP server receives the request message from the response message and contain the requested object and send the message into its socket. You can see here. After that, connection is closed. This will repeat for 10 objects. If the 10 objects are there, this will repeat 10 objects. I will repeat. Initially, this is the three-way handshake. Then fourth one is data transfer. So after that, termination of the connection, server closes the connection here. This is repeated 5 times or 10 objects are there 10 times. But in persistence, this is the non-persistence. So in persistence, this is the single connection. You can download several objects, required objects. But non-persistence, what is the disadvantage? The disadvantage is the RTT. You just see the RTT. RTT is nothing but round trip time, that is the time taken for the initiation of the connection and acknowledgement that has to receive from the server. This is called RTT. So for three-way handshake, you see three-way handshake itself, this is the RTT. After that, once this connection reaches here, that is the acknowledgement, once the acknowledgement from client to server reaches, then server will try to send send the file. Suppose the time to transmit the file, this is the time to transmit the file, and the file is received here, somewhere here, file is received here. So RTT, so you see two RTT plus file transmission time. This is the non-persistence HTTP response time for the single object. Just imagine now if 10 objects are there. So now, persistence, RTT is as little as one RTT for all the reference objects. And you see HTTP request message. Request line contains get, post, all those commands. And here you can see get and the path. And HTTP request method is general format, all these things you have to remember. Then uploading for this one is the post method is there, and other methods are there, URL method. So in HTTP 1, we have get, post, and add method, and HTTP 1, get 1.1, get, post, add, and put method is there. And HTTP response method, you can see, this is the status line. And status, other informations, header lines, and this data. In response message, we have data. In request message, data is not there. But in response message, you can see we have data here. Because in response message, the server will send the data, right? And error codes are there. 200 means okay. 300 means some address movement. 400 means bad request, not found. 5.5 means HTTP version not supported. All those are different types of error codes. So next one is cookies. So one problem of the HTTP server is that it will not keep the state or previous history of the connection. So many website for this purpose makes use of cookies. Cookies contains header line of the HTTP response message, cookie header line next HTTP request message, cookie file kept on the user's host managed user's host, the file is kept and managed by the user's browser. Backend will be and other information will be kept at database server, all those things. You can see here, you see the particular client, always she is trying to access eBay, and for that, when she access the particular site eBay, particular ID is created, and that ID is kept on the server as well as on the client machine, so that when the client access the same site on the next time, it will be helpful. So the particular client is normally accessing eBay. This time she is accessing Amazon. As soon as the her machine sends a HTTP request message, Amazon server creates ID for that, and it will keep that entry in the backend database. And reply response is sent. And now in the host machine, that particular ID is stored. When the user, after some time, when she next request for once again she access the same site, then the web browser at the client side will first send the cookies ID to the cookies ID to the backend database to the server, Amazon server, and she will get the response message faster. So this type of cookies helps in keeping states of previous state of user connection, and sometimes it will help for authentication or verification also, authentication verification, all those things. So what cookies can be used for? Authorization, shopping carts, recommendation, all those purpose, and to keep the state of the previous connection, cookies are used. So other than that, you have something called as web caches or proxy server. So if you use proxy server, it will be better, because when the client sends a request for particular, if that is not there in the server, it will respond, contact the original server. So in the diagram, client sends a request and particular pages is not available in the proxy server. The proxy server will request original server and it will try to get the response, and the same will be provided to the client. The next client here, once again, a request for the same web pages. Then same web pages response will be provided with a proxy server. So this will improve the performance. So now here our this client need not to wait for the origin server response from the origin server. So why we have to use the caching? Caching will reduce the response time for the client request, reduce the traffic on the institution's access link. Internet dense with the caches enables poor content provider to effectively deliver the content. So you can see it is found that if you without this one, without caching or proxy server, it is found that link utilization is 99% problem, but with the proxy server, it will be link utilization is less and performance is more. So that means web cache is cheaper than cheaper for accessing the various resources. So other than that, we have one more method that is called as conditional get method. Normally, once the proxy server gets the information of the particular object, it will store in the local database. So how long it can store the same object? Suppose the object may be modified at the original server. So when the client sends a request, it will send the request to the proxy server or to the main server, such that you send the object if not modified before the date. So in case it is not modified, the response is not modified. In case it is modified, the response is modified and data will be sent it back. So now next one is we have nothing but file transfer protocol. File transfer protocol makes use of it is a client server protocol. It makes use of port number 20 and 21. 20 is for data and 21 is for control. Control means to deal with the control signals, like to send and receive control signals. So it is used to transfer file from or remote host. You can see the client server model here, you can see. So client FTP clients contacts FTP server using port number 21, that is 21 is for control signals. And client authorized over the control connections. See here 21, client has to be authorized. Once authorization done, client browses the remote directory, sends the command over the connection, etc. And this then data transfer will be done by using port number 20. After that, the connection will be closed by the client. So my dear students, before I explain the other topic, let me first explain you how to use this command ipconfig slash all. This is the command. When you use this command, you can see here, you can see, so this is physical address. This is physical address, 48 bits. What I was telling, 48 bits or 6 byte physical address. This is the IP address of this machine where I am right now. I am using this machine. This is the IP address. This is the subnet mask. And my previous videos, if you have watched, then you'll come to know this is a class C address. And the default gateway, this is the router IP, default gateway. And DNS server, 192.168.0.1, this is a DNS server, 0.1 is also DNS server. So now, let me use the command ping. First, I have to check whether my machine is okay or not. That is, you can do by ping 127.0.0.1. This is, it will check the my machine with network card with the TCP/IP protocol is working or not. It will not send it a packet outside the network. It will loop the packet there itself. It will not send the packet outside the network. It will not send the packet from the network card to the outside. Either you can check like this. If you receive here, if you receive all the packets properly, sent 4, received 4. It has not sent anywhere. It has looped like this. See. Suppose this is my network card. This is network card. And here the cable is there. Cable is connected. The packet is sent here and looped like this. Received. It has not sent the packet on this cable. So sent and received. Lost is zero. That's the one way. Other way is you use the IP address itself. What is the IP address of your machine? So ping this one. Ping 192.168.0.100. Sorry, ping 192.168.0.100. See, 168.0.100. You are getting reply. If it is okay, then you check the gateway. Gateway is 1, router. Router is okay, connectivity is there. Then now I will check, everything is okay. Then I will check like ping www.microsoft.com. I don't know Microsoft.com address. I'll just type like this. And DNS server, my DNS server will resolve what is Microsoft. I wrote wrong this one. Let me correct once again. Control C. Microsoft.com. Microsoft.com. See, my DNS server has resolved this address. I don't know what is the Microsoft address. So I will write fully qualified domain name or URL. So DNS will resolve it. My DNS server at Airtel will resolve this one. And it has sent and received. So that is the. So now if you want to see the connection, exactly, you can use the command. So let me once again try here. One more command is there, trace alt or trace root. Trace Alt, and the this is www.microsoft.com. See this one, Trace Alt. You can see now, this is the IP address of Microsoft server. Now first the connection is going through my gateway is this one, then it is going through some other routers. It is sending packet through ICMP. It is taking this 8 millisecond. Now you see the packet is going through Airtel this one gateway. So it is taking time. What is the use of TraceRT and ping? Ping will not tell you where exactly the connection is drop out, but our TraceRT will tell you where the connection is drop out. Here you are not getting response. See here, request timed out. Where is the connection is drop out? So you can see now, it is going through various routers and different IP address. This is the class B IP address and all. See, finally, it went through all these different gateways. Tokyo, all those different gateways, and finally it got it. Trace is complete with this one. Deploy static. This it found the server is at this network. This one you can see. So this is the use of TraceRT. So DNS. DNS, I don't know the address, so I have to type IP address, name normally. So for example, how to check the address? For that we have one more command that is called as NS lookup. If I give here www.canara, Canara Engineering dot in, CANRA Canara engineering.in, we got the address. See, our DNS server resolved the address. It says like Canara engineering is 200.8.91.198.170. this is the Canara engineering, the website. Our website remains on this, it is there in this, on this server. I will quit this one and I will ping or TraceRT Canara CANRA dot in. You see, address is same. First DNS server will give the address, then the connection goes through my gateway here 192.168.1.16. Then you can see where our server is hosted, where our web pages are hosted. It's going through Airtel, of course, Airtel gateway. And where our web server is hosted, we'll come to know. What it's doing is TraceRT, it will send ICMP packet and try to get the reply with the TTL1, TTL2, TTL3, TTL4, like that. So it went through AAS underscore iPhone static, then it somehow timed out. Then somewhere in US server it is, this is hosted, it's the connection is going through that way. So maximum ops here is 30. Now 18 is over. 19. Trace complete. So it is hosted on webhostbox.net. On this server, this web pages is hosted. Our Canara engineering web pages is hosted. See. So this is the information I want to give you before I proceed. So now we will move to our FTP. So FTP, if you FTP www.microsoft.com. If you type something like this, sir, yeah, dear students, we'll see FTP. FTP means file transfer protocol. It is like built in the TCP software itself. Either you can store or you can install FTP server on your machine, and you can if you keep your machine in public domain, then it is accessible depending on the permission and authentication. So otherwise you can access FTP server. For example, I will give command FTP. When you give the command FTP, you will get this prompt. And here, if you question mark, then you can use this command in FTP. Now you are not connected to any server. This is the client, FTP client. You are not connected. Let me see now. I will use the connection. This one command open to connect. So open to connect. So let me check the free FTPs are available. So this is this one, SpeedNet. So let me copy this one here, open face. See, now it will ask user. User is anonymous. So in the here it is given anonymous. So I will copy this one. So user is anonymous, and password is also same, ANONYMOUS. It's connected now. I'm in their FTP server, and now you can give present working directory Unix command. You can see you are in root, and you can give the command ls minus l, and you can see various folders are there in there, this one. And if you want to upload or if you want to put some file here, you can use the command put, P-U-T, put. And I want to put the file 1.ppt to the from my machine, C colon 1.ppt to this server. See, it says could not create a file, some authorization problem. The command is successful, but some authorization problem. Yeah, some authorization problem. Like this, it will work. To disconnect, we have a command here. So if you give the question mark, you will come to know which are the command you can use. So like this. So FTP is the authorized authenticated protocol. Like without authentication, you cannot log in. So without authentication, you cannot log into the FTP. So it needs authentication. So this is about FTP. So next. Simple FTP command you just saw, list, retry, store, all those are simple FTP commands. And status code, cannot open the connection, error writing file, etc. So next one is SMTP, electronic mail, SMTP, POP3, IMAP, etc. All those things we will see in the next class. Thank you.